it's just a huge honor for me today to be podcast interviewing my buddy for 30 years, Lou Graham, out of Chicago with www.catapulteducation.com. Dr. Graham is an internationally recognized lecturer extensively involved in continuing education for dental professionals, focusing on incorporating current clinical advancements through conservative dentistry. He emphasizes in his teachings the same concepts he practices: dental health diagnosis, treatment plans for medically compromised patients, conservative treatment, cosmetic dentistry, and customized approaches to periodontal care, implants, and laser dentistry. He is the founder of the prestigious Catapult Group, a continuing education company whose philosophy and programs are use contemporary interactive formats to integrate time-proven conservative dentistry with 21st century materials and techniques. Dr. Graham is a published author in many leading national and international dental journals. He is a member of the American Dental Association, American Academy of Cosmetic Dentistry, Academy of General Dentistry, Chicago Dental Society, Illinois Dental Association, and since he lives in Chicago, we assume the mafia. Dr. Graham is a graduate of Emory Dental School, which they closed that school down after you graduated. They said, no more Lou Grahams, close that damn school down. He is the former dental director of the University of Chicago's Department of Dentistry. How cool is that? He enjoys providing dental care at his multi-specialty private practice group, University Dental Professionals in Chicago, Illinois, in Hyde Park. And I just want to tell you that I've seen you lecture several times. Last time I saw you lecture, I was with my buddy Bob Savage. And at the end of the show, he said, at the end of your course, he said, I don't know who's funny. He says, the three funniest guys in dentistry are Mike Dottola, Lou Graham, and Howard Frown. We laughed during the entire course while learning a lot of information. How are you doing, Lou?
I'm doing great. And Howard, I got to tell you, if you can have fun with education like you do, I mean, what beats fun in education?
So, you know, every time I hear your name, I always think of the song Lou Graham, Midnight Blue. Have you ever heard that song?
Yeah. Yep.
That is one of my top 100 songs. But he spells it different. He spells it with two M's.
Correct.
So that means you guys are not related. You're more distant than third cousins.
Probably beyond third cousins, yes.
But do you play a musical instrument?
No talent.
No talent? Yeah. You know, the only D I got in my life was in Spanish. My Spanish teacher told my mom I was linguistically retarded. And then the happiest day of my life was when mom said I no longer had to take piano lessons. And I said, why are you letting me out of this? You're making my five sisters keep taking it. And she said, well, the teacher said you couldn't carry a tune in a lunch pail, and that we're really wasting everyone's time. So that is not my deal. So everybody wants to know, you know, with what you talk about, what's bleeding edge new stuff and what's leading edge? I mean, a lot of dentists are kind of like, you know, I want to let my friends across the street try this stuff for 5 years before I put in. Because you and I have been doing this so long. We tried stuff that didn't work. I mean, Dicor crowns cemented with Duralon. That was my first taste of cosmetic dentistry. Art glass didn't do too well. Targus Vectris didn't do too well. You know, so a lot of times by the time you're as old as I am, you see something new and you think all the stuff you tried out of a box that you had to replace under warranty for free. But what's got you excited now? What's got you passionate that can give these dentists a competitive advantage?
Okay, so I'll throw it back to you and go, when we were in dental school, the two most diagnostic elements that we had were an Explorer and an X-ray, right? Yes or no?
Hey, I was so old, my Explorer was Christopher Columbus and Magellan. That's that's what we had to use for an Explorer.
Okay, so, okay, you are old. We're going to move beyond Christopher Columbus. Okay, so one of the things I love to incorporate in my practice that I think is a must is how do we get beyond guessing with Explorers and X-rays? Total guessing all the time. So in my practice now, hygienists, assistants, and myself and all my associates, mandatory diagnostics are right now three leading areas. One is fluorescence. I absolutely love Air Technique's Spectra system. It's great for fissures, smooth surfaces. Not doing a commercial, but I would never put a sealant in a tooth unless I knew there was nothing growing in the fissure. That's A. B, CariView is a transillumination technology from Dexis. so much more diagnostic for interproximal caries. And then once you can visually follow, then the question is, do you treat, do you use Icon to seal or infiltrate? It's an incredibly much more diagnostic technique than traditional bite wing x-rays. So I pose this to you, Howard. With an 18-year-old or a 16-year-old in my practice, why would I even take bite wing x-rays? And I can utilize CariView and see far more diagnostically than a traditional bite wing. Last thing I would say that has really blown me out of the water the last 2 years are comb beams. Comb beams are not just for implant placement. Comb beams for a general dentist in evaluating root canal therapies, retreatments, pathology. So many things that are going on in our practices. I probably do 35 scans a month, Howard. I charge $150 a scan. It's in my own dental plan, which we can get to later. There's just so much to share, but comb beams are also jazzing me. So I start off our day today with diagnostics.
Okay, so the problem we have right now is half of these people are on iTunes listening to sound. Describe to them with words, because they won't be able to, what is CariView? When you said, why do you need bite wing x-rays? They're driving to work right now and driving down the highway and say, how the hell does Lou diagnose cavities without a bite wing x-ray?
Right, so here's the truth. An Explorer is 50% accurate. An x-ray is at best 50% accurate, maybe 60% interproximally. So we're still guessing. So imagine taking a light and it's got literally two rubber nozzles, and it passes light as you hug a tooth with the rubber. And as the rubber nozzle hugs the tooth, it passes light through, and the thinnest area is obviously the interproximal area. So you can easily diagnose early dentin caries, which you can't on an x-ray oftentimes, deep enamel lesions, so maybe you can prevent it from growing. So it's really light passing through a tooth with literally two pieces of rubber holding the light on either side of the tooth.
So who invented that? It was in Canada, wasn't it?
From my understanding, it was out of Germany. Dexis is the company that brought it to the marketplace.
Wow. Yeah, on their Twitter, if you go to at DexisDental.com, their pinned tweet is, still using film at your practice? Oh, no, that's for the sensor. But I'll see if they got a caries detection, CariView. Yeah, they're with the Greater New York. So you like that CariView?
Well, I own three. Can't imagine not having both systems in my office. I just can't imagine it. Yep.
How much they cost?
I think they run, I would say, around $6,000, and you can bridge it to any radiology, digital radiology system out there, so it's fine. So you can absolutely bridge it if you're using Schick or something else and not Dexis. You can bridge the technology.
So Dexis bought Schick, or did Schick buy Dexis?
I don't think that has happened.
Oh, those are two separate companies?
Right. I'm just saying, if you own, you know, any type of digital sensor system, CariView can be bridged into your digital system.
Well, I'll tell you, on the website Dexis.com, that picture where you see that picture, you see that?
Yeah.
I mean, that is so cool. I mean, that is really cool. And I want to say, so you said diagnostic, you said fluorescence. You said CariView, and then cone beam.
Yep.
And I just want to say one thing before that, because I know everybody knows that magnification is how you become a better dentist with loops. But I'm still amazed at all the dentists that are listening right now that think, oh, yeah, I wear loops. Yeah, they wear loops, but they don't provide them for their hygienist or their assistant. And I made all my – everyone in clinical go to loops years ago, and a lot of them didn't even want to do it. And I said, I don't want you making a temporary on me, or I don't want you working on me without loops. And after I forced them, I just said, you have to wear loops. Oh my God, they're all addicted to it. They all just love it. I mean, how? So you can't be a quality hygienist, and you can't be a quality assistant with monkey eyes. I think everybody needs to wear loops. So go back to that fluorescence air technique spectrum.
Okay, so the theory is, just like the old diagonal instrument, it measures the degree of demineralization, how deep it is. So now, when you're evaluating patients without any restorations on their occlusal fissures, instead of guessing with an explorer, my hygienists don't use explorers. And absolutely, they must wear loops and lights. So we take fluorescence, and it takes about 2 seconds a tooth. And what you can actually do is save an image and then see 6 months later, did the image get worse? In other words, did the lesion get worse? So you can kind of now extrapolate and go, should I treat this or not treat this? So it gives you just a lot of information. And again, I just think this is information that we would never be using in Explorer to detect decay because it's so inaccurate.
Now, did air techniques originally, was that the micro-air abrasion?
No. Micro-air abrasion is a total different philosophy. That's where you can actually use air abrasion to clean out fissures and do small preparations. That takes you and I back years.
Yeah. So you like that. So you like the... And how much did that cost?
I think individually they sell a really great new camera, but I think the cost of that system is about $3,500 per operatory. And we share these, Howard. Let me be clear here. We share each of these between two or three ops, and there's a lot more I can say about them, but the first month we had CariView, we found 26 class 2 lesions. 26. So that paid for itself. And when the patient sees it, they buy into that they need the treatment.
And then when you were talking about cone beams, what brand are you recommending? When people come on this show and they say, you know, talk about implants, I mean, there's 175 different types of implants at the Greater New York meeting. And I just try to, and by the way, if you're listening to this, these are no commercials. No one's paid. This is my volunteer. My guests are volunteering. But I do just believe that it makes it easier to use and do if the implant guy would just say what his brand is. So what's your cone beam? Because there's so many different cone beams out there.
Okay, so I get to work with a lot of amazing companies. And so currently I have I actually have two cone beams in my office. Sounds crazy, but I have two offices. And my specialists and I, we absolutely need them. So in one office, we have an instrumentarium. I believe it's an OP300, 5 field of views. So my endodontist can use it. My surgeon can use it specifically with each field of view. The other system, which could be even the next state of the art, is a small company that very few have heard about. And it's called Prexion, Prexion. And Prexion, their images with their new release could be quite unbelievable. So this keeps getting better. And those are the two that I have in my office. And I'm waiting for the latest release.
The second one was Prexion. What was the first one?
It was Instrumentarium.
And where's Instrumentarium out of?
So Instrumentarium is out of Cave O'Kerr.
But where is it made at, though?
I think Instrumentarium is originally out of Finland. I believe it's Finland, and their main headquarters, I think, are out of Milwaukee.
And where's Prexion?
Japanese,
huh? Amazing. Yeah. I have a theory on Scandinavia. Those I've lectured so many times. There's so many great companies there. What's the one in Helsinki, Finland? What's the big one? Plan Mecca.
Yep.
When you go up there, I mean, this is true. When you go up there, those winters are so brutal that all those workers, everybody lives there, says the only way you can get through the winter is work 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, all through the winter. And it's just so, I mean, when you got 4 hours of light and it's 40 right. degrees below zero, those guys said, you know, the only way you can keep, because if you just stay home and relax, you just end up in a cold, dark home drinking.
And that's it, baby.
Yeah. And they say the way to stay on top of that winter. So those guys, they're just so productive.
Yeah,
I mean, my God, if I was gonna have a company somewhere else, I'd put it in northern Norway, because they wouldn't even want to leave work. They wouldn't even want to go home. They wouldn't even want to do the drive home. So you started off with diagnostics. You talked about fluorescence, Carrier View, cone beam. What next has you passionate?
So about 4 years ago, okay, we're going to stay, Howard, on the Scandinavian theme. So 4 years ago.
Can you name all five Scandinavian countries without Googling it?
So let me think. Well, let me ask you this. I know the big ones are Norway, Sweden, and Finland. And now the last two. Now, would Denmark be considered one?
Yes.
So I'm at four. What would be the fifth Scandinavian country? I'm thinking you're going to have to tell me.
Iceland.
Oh, I would never. Okay, you got me.
Reykjavik. Hey, and I got to ask you, which country in Europe is the largest by landmass? Which one is the biggest by land? Square miles, square kilometers?
Okay, is this a setup for Greenland?
It is. Because when you said Denmark, everybody says, oh, those countries are so small. It's like, dude, Denmark right. is the largest country in Europe because Greenland is all theirs.
I did not know that.
So what Scandinavian company were you going to go to? I'm guessing it had been Plan Mecca.
No.
No. Helsinki, Finland.
So the company, 4 years ago, they send us this calcium aluminate cement. I'm nervous because it's a cement, and the company's called Doxa. Zero customers in the U.S. This cement is the easiest cement to use. I use it routinely, all my posterior, Emax and zirconia, 80% of all my anterior work. And here's why it's so cool. It's grown from 0 to 8,000 customers. My doctors in Catapult love it. And what it does at the marginal interface, which is so cool, is early studies are showing that as it releases calcium, the phosphates from saliva remineralize the margin and can close minor gaps. If you can close a minor gap and have an active cement, you're minimizing the chance of recurrent decay. And that's the big bugaboo about a crown.
That's the Ceramer? Yeah. Ceramer?
It's called Ceramer, correct.
And you like that?
I probably will tell you, I can't tell you, in Catapult alone, we're talking thousands of units. That's probably been one of the must go-tos in my practice and Catapult other practices in the United States. Yes.
Okay, you've mentioned Catapult a couple of times. There might be some homies listening to you right now that say, what are you talking about? Talk about your legendary company, Catapult Group, which you can find at catapulteeducation.com.
So, like you, the world's not about Howard or Lou. And you've built a great, I'll call it a mini dental empire of online sources. And what I wanted to do was build a speaker bureau that could evaluate products, be sincere when we evaluate a product. So if a product sucks, I'm going to tell the company it's really bad. If it's great, then the company wants to work with Catapult speakers. I particularly then line up the speakers themselves are solicited by the companies to work with them because the speakers, the writers, and Catapult, they've shown a favorable review to a product. So I'm really connecting manufacturers to speakers. I love that. It's not about Lou Graham. It's about the whole entity of 50 guys. I love that. And that's really what I wanted to do. And the best part now is I have a lot of small companies who are coming to Catapult to see how do we get into the U.S. market. And so now we've got some incredible technologies coming in. They'll be launched in the next year or two, and they're come through Catapult, so we can be their means to get into dental offices around the States and hopefully globally.
Yeah, you're amazing. What I also love about you is you do online CE too, right?
We do. If I can be the number two player after you, I'm willing to take that. We hooked up with a company in social media called My Social Practice. And now, Howard.
Out of Utah.
Out of Utah. And now what we're doing is we're putting on the most contemporary online education courses, both 5-minute learning And then obviously webinar learning where you can get CE credits and stuff. But the whole idea is to make everything more customized to what each dentist wants to listen to. And we can kind of track that and customize what they should be wanting in the future to engage online education in.
Now, you know, I told you my theory of why there's so many great dental companies out of Scandinavia, right?
Go.
You know why there's so many great dental companies out of Utah?
Tell me.
I'm not making this up. It's because each one of those guys has a stay-home wife and somewhere between 6 and 112 children, and they just work. When I talk to the CEOs, I'm not making this up. When I talk to the CEOs of these big corporate dentistry, they said if they could hire only Mormon male dentists with a stay-home wife with four kids, they go back and look at their numbers, and they say, our Mormon dentist who has a stay-home wife with three or four or five kids, oh, my God, they're the hardest-working people on earth. And when I hire some kid out of school and he's single, he don't want to stay after 5 o'clock and do an emergency. He's already got his eyes on happy hour, and he wants to go have a martini and chase girls and all that. And I'm telling you, in the United States, the hardest-working people I know are Mormons up in Utah or down here in Mesa or Gilbert or whatever.
Right.
So my social – and the other thing I love about you is so many people – think in fear and scarcity. Like when I opened up my practice 30 years ago, half the dentists in my zip code didn't want to have anything to do with me, and they're telling me I shouldn't have set up there and it's too crowded and rah, 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 rah. The other half were like, come on in, have a beer, let's go eat a cheeseburger. And they just thought in hope, growth, and abundance. And 30 years later, guess who crushed it? And I love the fact that some people, I say, oh, you got to come on my show. They say, I can't. I write for another dental magazine, or I have a competing product. It's like, my homies don't read one magazine. They read five or six. They don't go to the Greater New York doesn't compete with the Chicago Midwinter and the ADA. And my God, if my social practice puts on online CE and it helps my homies do dentistry better, faster, easier, at a lower cost, higher quality, should I be your biggest promoter?
Love you too.
I mean, there's 2 million dentists on earth. I mean, we all need to stick together. And I like that. You have always thought in hope, growth, and abundancy, not fear. So when does the social practice online CE start?
So I think probably by midwinter, by February of 2017, next February. But we'll be really full blown. Got a lot of clients ready to go. Targeting education.
What's the website going to be for that?
It will be catapulteeducation.com.
Oh,
it will
be on yours. It's going to be on yours. It's not going to be on my social practice.
No. They're just, their group came in to help build our company internally so that we can really get far more advanced in the technologies out there. Cause I certainly can't do it without that kind of help. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, Jack Hadley,
Jack's one of my best buddies. He's amazing.
I love that guy to death.
Yep. Is he not the best?
Oh, my God. He is just, he's the coolest guy, and he's an Ironman.
What does that mean? You mean far as an athlete?
Yeah, have you heard of the Ironman?
Of course. Okay, I wanted to make sure I was with you.
Yeah, I love telling people I did the Ironman because no one could believe that this fat grandpa of a self did it. But I did three in a row, and he was a big inspiration of me getting into that. And he's just an all around just a super cool dude.
He's a cool guy.
So we'll just stay there for a minute because I want you to see if you agree. I mean, when I go back and look at 30 years, I mean, I've been doing this 30 years, and when I look at successful people who, success meaning they accomplished all their goals and dreams or whatever it might be, you know, some were low volume, panky type practices. Some were high volume. I mean, I saw every business model known to man, but the one thing they all had in common, they all took about 100 hours of CE a year. They were always finding and filling their brains with the latest, fresh, great, motivational, whatever. And so it's so important. That's why I'm a big supporter of the AGD, getting your fellowship, your mastership. That's why I did these podcasts, because I thought, okay, if these millennials got an hour commute to work and I can get on amazing guests like you to put great ideas in their head, and they're in Parsons, Kansas, they might only have a study club, you know, the last Tuesday of every month from 7 to 8, and it might be some local speaker. How has CE changed from when you and I got out of school to now?
I would say not as much as it should have. I think the traditional way of going to take a course for 7 hours from one speaker, I mean, put a gun to my head, Howard. I mean, the speaker's exhausted, the audience is exhausted. So I think education is now going to more half-day, one-hour programs, more live courses where you can do more hands-on. I think how we combine what you do with live courses, so go take a live course and then do a bunch of continual courses that could be online. That's how you really better yourself. There's only so much you can learn live. I think it's the continuum that really will make huge differences in each of our offices, because you're going to want to customize what you're looking for and then staying on top of that. I really think online can really help support live.
And, you know, I think I don't want to go into politics, sex, religion, violence, anything controversial, but I really hope they close down the Department of Education, because I have an online CE on my deal. So I read all the online literature, and our schools, obviously the research is saying that kids don't even retain anything till like after 10. So right. Why are you waking them up? And when I woke up my four boys, they used to beg to let them sleep. But you had to force them to get them to school. Now the research shows they don't even learn it. They don't even retain anything past 10. They also said that after 15 minutes, they're in a daydream. They're out fishing and catching frogs and riding bicycles. They're not even paying attention. So shorter, more focused increments.
Yes, exactly.
And how many lectures have you gone to in your life where after lunch, what percent don't come back? And then what percent don't come back after the afternoon break?
I know. It's so embarrassing when you're attending a program and it's like a ghost town when you come back at 1 o'clock. Yep.
Yeah. So the future's got to be shorter, more focused burst of information, not these 8-hour mega marathons where you're just trying to back their pounding coffee just so you can stay awake till the end.
Couldn't agree more. I couldn't agree more. Yep.
Yeah. I want to go into some. This is Dentistry Uncensored. I want to go into some really controversial stuff. The kids are loud and clear. They're coming out $350,000 of student loans. And the power, you know, and everybody's saying, dude, you need to double that with three moves. A CERAD machine, a CBCT, and a laser. And they're saying, damn, I'll go from 350 under to 750. And then, what do you think about these high ticket items? If you're $350,000 in debt, you're 25 years old, and you're like, really?
Well, let me be sincere. I think the number one thing a kid coming out of school, if they're going to open their own practice, they have to, like you would believe this, of course, they have to know what do they want to accomplish in their practice? What's their philosophy? That's the first thing before you go shopping. Second thing is how do you analyze your growth of your practice? So there's a company out there called Dental Intel, also out of Salt Lake City. And the analytics they can run on a practice, how can you run a business and know what to buy unless you know the numbers and how you run a business? And most dentists are clueless. So we implemented Dental Intel 6 months ago, and it's already revolutionized our bookkeeping, our accounting, our incentives. Everybody now, we can monitor treatment plans, reappointments. So that alone tells you how to start running your office. So the second thing I would do is I would not invest in a comb beam. I would go out and start thinking, instead of hiring Mary, Jim, and John, I would look at a company like Weave. Weave is also out of Salt Lake City. Why?
They're all out of Salt Lake City.
Right. I know, because they work 20 hours a day. So Weave, the reason I think this is so cool is when a receptionist picks up the phone, she sees all their information, doesn't have to go to a chart. It's all about how much time he or she saves. So once you're taking care of your customers efficiently, keeping your costs down, now how do you want to build your practice? Now we can go into the high-tech merchandising. And honestly, I think a CERAC is fine if that's what somebody wants to do, and that's fine. Do they want to do same-day dentistry? If you're in Nebraska and people are out there driving 2 hours to an appointment, they're going to want the crown the same day. They're not going to want to come back. But does everybody need a CEREG? No. I think openly, it's how do you want to build your practice? What do you want to concentrate on? Then you start figuring all those high-ticket items.
Okay, I want to ask you a question about weave.
Okay.
And this is a, and I know this is hard for you to answer because you're talking to dentists right now in 150 countries, and within America, there's a big difference from where you are in Chicago and where somebody might be in Parsons, Kansas. But this is a going from a hardwired landline to a VOIP, a voice over internet protocol internet. And some people with Weave say, you got to have a solid internet connection. Because if you don't have a solid internet connection and your phones are all over the internet, what happens when the internet goes down for 10 or 15 minutes? Or talk about that.
So first off, it's a great point. And I was lucky enough to meet the top people there. And as any technology, we will be doing VoIP no matter what in the future. That's where we're all going. It will be technology. So their version one was a wonderful version, but had internet snags and internet problems. They're updating all their customers on version two. An amazing, what I would say, upgrade based on the problem you're talking about, Howard. There's no doubt about it. So openly, it's the biggest concern is an office going down. But their target focus is to make sure that's at a minimum. And right now they're at a 99%. So it was definitely an issue. My office experienced the issue. We were very open about it. But I firmly believe this is the future of where we're going. So, you know, you take a company like the Solution Reach, where we went from texting and confirming and doing all those wonderful things, great company. And now all these next companies are all about efficiency. And I do think it will continue to go that way.
You said I wouldn't go out and buy a CBCT. You said I'd get Weave. I get dental intel. Continue. CEREG is the $150,000 decision. And 25-year-old kids, that's a big decision for them. At our age, you and I are just thinking, hell yeah, we'll buy it because we don't want to give it to our damn kids and grandkids. We're going to die anyway. Why not just buy a toy for a boy? I mean, boys got to have toys, and I have all those toys, but I don't like to talk about those toys because how I'm buying this with my student loans paid off at 54 is different than someone buying it at 24.
Oh, I couldn't. And that's my whole thing. I think every young dentist today, different than when you and I graduated, has to know, how do I run my business better? How do I make my employees more efficient? And from there you go on. So after we establish that, then we can talk about key products in dentistry. And I would tell you honestly, one of the key products, Howard, I don't know what your practice is like, but let's talk just useful, unbelievable tools. I can't imagine having practices without lasers today. I don't know what your experience is, but all my hygienists are trained on diodes. We have CO2s. We just got AMD's new erbium laser. Fontana's supposed to be an amazing laser. Millennium treating Lanap. I mean, I see lasers being a part of a huge continuum of a boom of multidisciplinary dentistry.
Who was that pediatric dentist in Chicago that just passed away that was the early adopter of all those lasers on children?
Oh, I loved him. Fred Margolis.
Oh, my God. I almost cried when I heard he passed away. He was a pioneer of lasers on children.
Yeah. Well, think about it. You can use an erbium laser. There's no drill sound. Routinely, you can cut into dentin without any sensitivity. You're making the experience a total different experience than an injection and everything else. And that's what Fred was all about. I can't compliment Fred. He was an amazing man. Yeah.
Yeah, a legend. And the greatest obituary I read on him was for a young lady girl who, when she got out of pediatric dentistry, she went and hung out with him, and she just credits him to just opening eyes. It was beautiful. Here's what I think they don't focus on enough. You know, everybody keeps talking about same day crown, same day crown, same day crown. Come on, I've been a dentist for 29 years in Phoenix, and when I tell someone they need a crown, the asking if they can have it on the same day comes up like once a decade. What comes up half the time is, I'm scared to death. I don't want a shot. Can you knock me out? Can you give me laughing gas? And then the other half's fear. How much is this? Do you take my insurance? I don't get paid till Friday. And these people who say these hard tissue lasers cut slow, well, dude, you're numbing up. Then you're leaving the room for 10 minutes, coming back. Now they don't get a shot. Yeah, it's slower, but by the time they would have been numbed up, you're done.
Totally agree. Totally. Oh, for class ones and twos and fives, these lasers are, I mean, these hard tissue lasers are amazing. And I mean, Howard, AMD just launched their Light Touch at around $40,000. So we're not at this $95,000, which is just, that's such a huge number, such a huge difference.
I know. And that's AMD is Alan Miller Design Laser. He's a Hoosier out of Indiana. And that guy is the number one genius at cutting costs out of producing lasers. I mean, he's the one who took the diode from 10 grand to half, and he's right. Taken the hard tissue lasers. That's an erbium, that Light Touch?
Yes.
And he's cut the costs in half. I mean, he's just a genius guy.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you, there are few individuals in dentistry that are as, and I'm going to say this, as sincere, but he is a crazy fun guy in our field. He challenges the norm across the board. And I love that because you and I respect and admire people like that. I know that about you. And I love Alan Miller. He's an amazing guy. Yeah.
Yeah. He is man. He's amazing. So talk about that Light Touch. So he's got that under 50, it's 49K.
And I think it's pretty much like a 45-ish K type deal, just on a routine deal. So imagine now I'm doing a crown prep. The decay is deep. I'm violating my biologic width. You take a setting and you just, in a closed flap, remove a little bit of bone right then and there, Howard. I've done the crown lengthening. I take my impression, and the efficiency and all that is unbelievable. That's where I see all these things helping dentists.
Hey, I want to ask you a religious moral ethics question. That I've got a lot of pushback on this, and I've got some pretty nasty letters about this from insurance people, but this comes from my heart. I mean, I always say what I believe, and the reason I'm not politically correct is I believe that if you're really my friend, you want to know what I think. You don't want me to tell you what I think you want me to tell you, and this is what I believe. I believe sealants suck. I believe you're taking a tooth with pits and fissures filled with crap and melunk and all this crap. You're acid etching with technology for bonding to bond to enamel, but you're not on enamel. You're on pits and fissures filled with bacteria, fungi, virus, Oreo cookie, Cheez-Its, and you only get $40. And I believe the research is clear in that in a year, half are failed, and in 2 years are all failed. So if you think you're putting a sealant on a six-year molar and it's still there in there 4 or 5 years later, I think you're crazy. But if you took a hard tissue laser and you lasered out those pits and fissures, in my hands, it's 100% of the time you're in Denton. Now you're not doing a $40 sealant that's half will fail the first year, half will fail the second. Now you're billing a $150 occlusal composite, and in 5 years, they're pretty much all going to be there. I think sealant should be replaced with hard tissue lasers and bill occlusal composites. And some say that ain't right.
That ain't right.
You think that ain't right?
I'll tell you why.
You don't like that either?
So I'll tell you why. Okay. So here I'll take my spectra. I'll look at a kid, and I'll be able to see where the caries is, if there's even caries. If the enamel is solid and the kid is low caries risk, I don't touch the kid. I do nothing, and I just follow him. If the kid is high caries risk and we do some diet changes, I may go in with my laser, just open up the groove, creates a cool etch, and then just either put a flowable composite or a sealant in, but I'm diagnostically driven. I do not want to, I think dentists way over prepare teeth. So I know what you're saying. A lot of glass ionomers fail. They're not retentive. I'd rather do nothing and monitor or place a minimally invasive sealant, which is oftentimes a sealant or a flowable or a glass ionomer. But I don't want to prep into Denton unless I have to. But I understand what you're saying, but I'm more minimalistic.
Okay, Ryan, where he just disagreed with me, I want you to edit all that part out so everything he just said will not be heard. Can you do that for me? Well, you know,
don't listen, Ryan.
My bird brain is kind of like, you know, my mom, bless her heart, loved her death. She had seven kids, you know. But she loves two things that don't go together. She loves these mulberry trees in her backyard because she makes mulberry pies. And she loves birds, so she has all these bird feeders. So the birds are eating the mulberries, and there's purple bird shit on everyone's car for four houses each way. And everybody on the block except my mom, you know, wants to kill the lady that's growing mulberry trees with birdhouses hanging. I mean, you just don't hang a birdhouse in a mulberry tree. My point being, if I take that birdhouse and fill it in with cement, I don't ever have to worry about a bird again. If I take that hard tissue laser or a burr and I clean out that pit and fissure and I fill it with composite or amalgam or whatever, I don't have to worry. But you think that's too aggressive?
Well, here's the question. Everything leaks. So after 5 years, do I have a bigger problem in 5 or 10 years versus having done it at all? That's what I'll ask you.
Okay, then now I want to ask you another question. And we've both been doing this for 30 years. You got out of Emory in 82. By the way, what year did they shut that school down?
I think 85-ish, I think.
So you're going to go on the record and say they didn't close down because of you? You were.
I'm not their most famous alumni, that's for sure.
I wonder if they'll ever, with all these new schools open up, I always wondered if Emory will open that thing back up.
Got taken over by the medical school.
Yeah, same with Northwestern in Chicago.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, has dentistry, I'm going to ask you this, has restorative dentistry gone backwards? Because when you and I got out of school, the majority of dentists were all placed in amalgams, and they lasted 30, 40 years. They were metal. They were antibacterial. I mean, hell, they're half mercury. The other half was silver, zinc, copper, tin. We have the pediatric dentist using silver. What are the pediatric dentists using? Silver, silver diamine fluoride.
Yeah.
The hygienists use stannous fluoride, which is tin. Silver, zinc, copper, tin, mercury. I mean, none of them are found in a multivitamin. They're all antibacterial. And then we decided to go on this journey of the aesthetic health compromise and replace all those metal antibacterial bacterial static fillings with a bunch of inert plastic composite. And my question is, they last half as long. Do you think dentistry was better when you were in Emory and I was in the University of Missouri, Kansas City? Because back then, real dentists did fillings that last 30, 40 years, and now we're all slugging this white inert plastic stuff.
I can't say at all you're wrong, because openly, Howard, I think you've touched on a really sensitive subject. 80 or 90% of what I do is replacing what was done 10 years ago. And those are not amalgams. Those are composites. And you and I both know that.
And you know, and those early guys who jumped on the composite bandwagon, I'm not going to say their names because it'll get back to like Dickerson and Hornbrook and those guys. You know, they were saying, you know, I remove these black amalgams and I always find this black scuzz. It's like, really, black scuzz? When I remove a composite, I find mush. I'm with a number 4 round burr taking out oatmeal. When I took out these 30, 40-year-old amalgams, oh, there was some black scuzz. I'll go back to black scuzz any day. And I think the holy grail for the future of like 3M and Ivoclar is, I mean, can't they put something in that restoration that was like 10 ions flying out of amalgam, silver ions, something that gives it some antibacterial. Lou, when I go to a continuing education course at Greater New York, Chicago Midwinter, whatever, and I listen to these guys talk about composites, you'd think we were all engineers. They're talking about like wear rates and bonding strengths. And when they spend 2 hours talking about the wear rates of all the different composites, now there's better. It's like, well, that ain't my problem. I don't put in fillings, and the problem is they all wear down. And then they talk about bonding strengths and who's got the best. That ain't my problem. I don't put in tooth color fillings. They all wear down and fall out. My problem is they're all attacked by 10 billion bacteria, fungi, and virus in the mouth. And it's kind of like building a barn. I mean, I build this barn, and 6.5 years later, termites demolished it. And I don't want to talk about the strength of the boards and the bonding rates of the nails. I mean, we're not engineers. We're actually biologists. I mean, we fight biology. We fight gram-negative anaerobes and viruses and fungi, and it just seems like these It just seems like we've gone too mechanical engineer. We forgot about biology, and the patient's getting served with fillings that last half as long, but they look pretty.
And I'll say this. I think a good dentist can make a really nice conservative restoration. I think they can last not as long as an amalgam, no doubt. Let me also say, I think Howard will have gone through an era of composites, and there's no doubt they are not the end all of be all. I think we'll have gone through an adhesive era. I'm pretty sure that's what you're thinking.
Yeah, I mean, mine are all gold because I think people forgot the lesson of gold. You know, I'm out here in Phoenix with a bunch of retired ladies that lived in your town.
Right.
There are so many people that retire here from Chicago and Canada, North and South Dakota, and they got gold foils that are so old, and you can see the margin, you can see the holes, you could blow your air water syringe through them. But that high surface gold, there's no decay.
Right.
And CapTech had research showing that when you put that high surface energy gold, it kind of like if I moved into an apartment and it was all static electricity and every time I touch something, I got zapped, I don't want to live there. And then I go into the next apartment, it's all made out of inert plastic, resin, composite, and I say this. So I have just personally seen that we've gone from restorations of gold, high noble, high energy gold, and amalgam to just a bunch of inert stuff, and it just doesn't have me, I just think it's a huge compromise. I mean, you'd have to double the dentist if all the stuff only lasts half as long.
No, I'm not arguing. And it may not even last that long if the dentist is in a rush. They're doing quick work because they're part of like a mill. Man, those restorations, they start failing. The minute someone walks out of the chair, they're already leaking. And you know it.
Yeah. Yeah. So then do you have amalgam in your office?
I haven't placed an amalgam in probably 25 years. I will tell you this. I spend a lot of time doing the composites the right way. I do composites. I like to save teeth as much as possible. But Howard, I got to go with you on this. I use glass ionomers as bases, as sealant material a lot of times. And there are a lot of cool materials that are coming out that are kind of glass ionomer composites that I think are the next stepping stone away from composites for sure.
Which are what? Give names.
One name would be a product from PulpDent called Activa. I know you've heard of it. Their studies are quite impressive. It's a great geriatric repair. It's a great liner. I think that's huge. I think Bisco makes a great liner called Theracal. Very bioactive. I see these as things as next steps. Even a product like a geomer from Shofu, where they're showing six ions, it goes back to your ions. They release six ions. So all of these things, I think, are where the future is going into the next breakthrough, which will be ionic release. You want ions to release to create new tooth regrowth or at least minimize decay. I couldn't agree more.
And who did you say, that Bisco? That's right in your backyard, Bisco.
Bisco makes a product called Theracal. It's a bioactive liner, calcium, a resin calcium silicate. That's a hot new liner. Well, I can't even say new. It's been around 4 years now. It's amazing how time flies.
Now, since he's in your backyard, do you ever go see Byung Sa?
I love that man. He's amazing. Amazing.
I know, and he won't come on my show. He's the typical older conservative, you know, guy, and they don't like to draw attention to themselves. It was so hard to get that generation. You know, whenever I try to go after that generation, it would be my father's age. They're afraid of stuff. Tell him he's got to come on the show. I mean, he could be talking, because when I sat next to him at seminars and things like that, Byung Sa has got to be one of the smartest dental materials geniuses. I mean, he invented all bond.
Right.
I mean, he is just amazing, but he never talks himself. I mean, you know how many people buy from Bisco and couldn't pick that guy out of a police lineup?
Oh.
I mean, what percent of dentists that buy Bisco have never even seen him?
They wouldn't even know the name. They wouldn't. Yeah.
I know. I think he is just an amazing guy. You got to get him on the show.
Okay, I'll do it. Then you owe me a drink. Okay.
Catch him after he's done golfing, and then maybe he's had a few beers.
It'll be more entertaining for sure.
Okay, so what else has got you passionate? I mean, we're almost going through an hour, but I hate to let you go. I want to keep picking your brain.
Okay, so one of the favorite things I've done in my office. So my office is a multi-specialty office. All the specialists work with me. I have three associates. I think it's the future of dentistry. If you don't want to be in corporate America, work with a group. I think that's the best thing you could ever do. So what I did was I created my own dental plan. Did I lose you?
No, I said, what's the website of your dental group?
Okay, my website would be udpdentistry.com.
UDP Dentistry. What's UDP stand for?
University Dental Professionals.
So UDP what?
UDPDentistry.com. Or it may be UDPDentistry.net. Check it. One of the two, it's one of them.
Okay.
So one of the things we did, Howard, was the growing population where we can make, I call it good living, is those over 70. And we created our own dental plan in our own office. And basically, our own dental plan is all about prevention. And think about this. A patient would pay me $400 a year. It includes two hygiene visits, all the exams, all the diagnostics, everything. And all the dental work is then discounted with no limits, 15%. 15% discount. I've got them locked in as patients. And they just have to pay time of service. There's no financing. So I've got money in my bank account. They're prepaying their $400 a year. And now all of them get quality dentistry, no limits, no insurance companies. And what we're finding thus far is I've eliminated all my doctors except one being on a PPO. So if I can get the PPOs out from my practice with discounts of 50%, I'd rather just be better taken. I'd love taking care of my patients the way I want to and not having a company dictate to me pricing.
Now, did you set that up yourself or did you use a company to help you set that up?
I did it myself. It's pretty darn easy.
And here's what these kids need to listen. Think about this if you're a young millennial. I mean, why would Sam's Club not let you come in there and buy all this stuff? They want you to get a membership because it emotionally commits you. Same right. thing with Sam's Club, Costco, Amazon Prime. Costco says that we're not going to let anybody in because when we get you to commit to being a member, now you're loyal and we retain you twice as long. You're like, oh, well, I have a membership to Costco. So you shop there for 10, 20, 30 years. By getting them to come in and signing up to, it's really a loyalty program. Forget the That's math and finance.
Right.
They just think,
right.
Well, I'm going to, what is it? United Dentist?
No. Okay. Pay attention.
Here, I'm, I just got the website.
Okay.
It's udpdentistry.com.
Okay.
And that's University Dental Practice. No. University Dental Professionals.
Right.
Dentistry.com. UDPDentistry.com. But yeah, these loyalty programs, I mean, what I've always done in my little business is steal every idea I can from the Fortune 500. And if Sam Walton was here today, or who was the guy who started Price Club? Saul Price. If Saul Price was alive, if Sam Walton was alive, they would sit there and say, get them to become a member.
Right.
Don't let them come in until you get a membership out of them, and then they'll never leave you.
Hello. Hello. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So you said you have every specialty under, you have every specialty. I'm calling bullshit. You don't have a public health dentist. You don't have
bullshit.
an oral. You do?
No, a public health specialist. What is that?
The ADA has 9 specialties. One of them's public health dentistry. One of them's oral radiology diagnostics.
Okay. I do that. Go on.
So how many dentists, how many operatories, which specialties?
So I have 9 ops, 4 hygienists, and I have endodontist a day a week, prosthodontist a day a week. So we do all our all on fours in house. She's amazing. I have a periodontist. I have an orthodontist. I just hired an oral surgeon to replace my last one. And I'm working out to hire a sleep TMJ doctor so we can keep everything in office. This is the fastest growing aspect of dentistry, multi-specialty under one roof.
And that's and what are your hours?
So it's all, we start at 7 o'clock. We first huddles at 6:40. We do two huddles because there's two teams. First huddles at 6:40, second huddles at 7:40. We work from pretty much, I'll say 7 a.m. to 5. We're going to expand hours when we continue to need to. Saturdays included every other. Most of my employees, Howard, work 4 days. Most are mothers, and I want them to have 3 days at home. So pretty much everybody's on 4 day work shifts.
Well, the thing I believe is that it's if grandpa goes to the doctor and he says, I need you to go see a cardiologist and I need you to go see an endocrinologist about your thyroid. And he gives them four referrals to four different specialists. What does 90% of the grandpas do when they walk out the front door before they get in their truck?
Tell me.
Throws them all away.
Right. Exactly.
If you don't make it easy and convenient, right, grandpa ain't going to do it.
Right.
I met so many rural dentists. I said, well, why did you get into endo, ortho, whatever? And he said, well, if I tell them to go drive 45 miles down the highway to the endodontist, they're not going to do it. Then I see them a month later and they're all swollen up and I have to pull it anyway. So they're not going to drive an hour.
You know? I agree. But that's why not treatment plan, treat all in one office? I really think it's where we're all going. I couldn't agree more.
Hey, I just found you on Twitter, UPD at UPDDentistry.com. I just retweeted you. So you're not following anybody on your Twitter.
I don't do Twitter.
Well, you have to tell your Twitter they have to follow me. I'll be the only one you follow. Oh, man. So that's an hour, but I still don't want to let you go. Do you have any other thing? I know you could talk for 40 days and 40 nights.
Okay. My last thing that I will want to talk to you about is growing a practice. That's what your reader, that's what your listeners want to do most. Grow a practice, yes or no?
Yes.
And I think growing a practice today is all hygiene driven. I think the more you keep a wonderful hygienist or two busy, the amount of value in that hygiene program, we call it the wheel. Howard, I would tell every young dentist out there, you build a successful hygiene relationship, have one core philosophy. I think that's how you build a practice. Forget marketing to all, you know, mail marketing and all that stuff. Build a great website, have great value, create hygiene driven, and you will be very successful. That's what I would end on today.
Okay, well, I want to end on a different question.
Okay. I knew it.
Okay. You know that every dental graduating class for the last 487 million years comes out and complains the dental school didn't teach them everything. And they're coming out of school, and this is what they're specifically asking. They're saying, okay, I'm out of dental school, and I can't afford to learn everything. I can only learn one thing at a time, but what do you think is the best thing to learn first, then second, then third? Because they're being tempted to go to Dominican Republic with Arun Garg and learn how to place implants and buy a CBCT and all that. That's a big investment. Then there's people saying, no, you need to go to Panky and Coys and Spear and learn TMJ and occlusion. Then there's people saying, no, you got to learn sleep apnea and obstructive sleep medicine. Then there's people saying, no, you need to learn short-term ortho and Invisalign. And what they're asking specifically, Lewis, what is the best return on investment? I want to learn them all someday. I mean, someday I want to be able to do all that stuff. But right, I can't do all of them at the same time. Where would you recommend they go on their journey?
So I would certainly say this. Journey is, honestly, know the basics. People forget the basics. And the basics are easy enough to go, just learn how to be a really good general dentist in year one or year two. Learn how to do good endo. That's not that challenging with all the technologies today. after I've learned good endo, I've learned how to do good restorative the right way. Now you're ready if you want to start taking that next level of placing implants. I think placing implants will be, I mean, Howard, I'm now working with a company that shows you three-dimensionally live as you're placing your implant, the direction it's going in. So it's almost, it's going to be so hard to screw up. So I do think implants are going to be pivotal in every young dentist's career. I don't think that's going to be that difficult. And I think the end stage of what you're looking to in year 5 to 10 is really going then and taking a Spears curriculum or a Coise curriculum or following a dentist on the curriculum you want. If you want to do TMJ in sleep, I think it's a wonderful commitment. But is that what you want to concentrate on and do correctly? Just moving a jaw forward is not treating sleep apnea. It's ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. I think you have to dive deep, and once you learn the basics, what you want to do in your future. But you got to know the basics. That's the core of dentistry.
And last but not least, it seems like, do you agree or disagree? It seems like they come out of school. It seems like there's only two types of dentists. They're either blood and guts barbarians and love root canals, oral surgery, gum surgery, place implants. Or they just like the clean and pretty stuff, and they like cosmetics and ortho and sleep and Invisalign. Do you see people that like one or the other? Do you think most people like one or the other, or do you think a lot of people like both?
No, I'd say most people are one or the other for sure. No, I think in our day, you had to do everything. If you didn't like blood and guts and everything else, I don't know how you made a living back then. But today, I think it's a little bit more boutique-ish on what you like. I think it's usually one or two. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, 29 years later, when I get done with the procedure, if I don't see some little specks of blood on my bald head, I know I didn't even have fun. I love the wisdom teeth, the root canals. Yep. I just like the blood. Last question. I swear it'll be the last question. A big one. Since you and I have been out of school, the only major consumer brand that was built was Invisalign. What would you say to a 25-year-old girl driving down the road right now saying, Lou, should I learn Invisalign what would you say?
I think you have to learn Invisalign until the next Invisalign comes. Invisalign, it's a really expensive way to do business, but it can open up so many doors in how to treat people. I don't think the learning curve's that tough. In my practice, I have two associates. We do a ton of it. I think the same thing about 6 month smiles. I think ortho, adult ortho, is a huge opportunity in our practices. I really do. Yep.
Yeah. Well, hey, I just want to say thank you so much for coming to my show. Thanks for thinking in hope, growth, and abundance, and not thinking, oh, I compete with Howard and I, because you know, you and I, we just want these kids to do dentistry faster, easier, better quality, lower cost, and have fun and be happy and healthy. And I just love the fact that people like you that are bigger than that want to give back to dentistry more than they're trying to protect some little piece of turf or, you know, whatever. And anything you do, anything you want me to do to help promote what you're doing, because I have been a big fan of the Catapult Group, which I guess you changed the name to Catapult Education. I mean, when I was getting my FAGD and MAGD, I can't think of how many times I saw you. And who's the other guy, your buddy in San Antonio?
Dave Little.
God, I love that guy. Is he still on
Great
your
guy.
Group?
You bet he is.
And a pediatric dentist in Canada.
Carla Cohn, amazing.
Oh, my God. You have some of the most amazing people. You have just a collection of just some of the most amazing, high-energy, fun guys. And the last time I saw you in Phoenix, me and Bob Savage sat back there. We laughed so hard, we thought we were disrupting the class.
I love to hear that, especially from you. It makes my Friday.
All right, well, you just made my Friday. So we should start a mutual admiration club, and we'll be the only two members. Thanks
kiss,
so
kiss.
Much.
Love you.
Love you. Go to catapulteeducation.com. Lou Graham, have an awesome day.
You too, my man. Thank you.
Bye-bye.